Dalam rangka Disnatalis UB yang ke-55, Universitas Brawijaya mengadakan kegiatan International Conference on Higher Education and Enhancing Competitiveness in Asia yang diselenggarakan di Widya Loka UB.
Selanjutnya, I would like to talk about the trend of education right now, especially in the face of 21st century. Okay, the basic questions of my wishes is that have our education instructions fulfill the needs of the students in order to prosper in 21st century. And if it is not, then what is the solution we as the teachers? But if it is has not been done, then how to extend it to how to make it sustainable in the future? Now, let's take a look at some issues related to the current education trend, especially in Indonesia. The first is that right now students demand more, okay, that is like language and arts, or maybe if students are from scientific and exact fields, they demand more than what science, technology, engineering and mathematics. They need something more skillful, like interpersonality, collaboration, empathy, and also motivation. Those skills are not accommodated very well so far in our current education. Now let's focus on Indonesia. The current results of ABC or PISA, or test program of international students assessment, that concerned with student literacy, mathematics, and reading, Indonesia since 2013, that was 2010, Indonesia has been on a very low level of literacy compared to the other countries. Even in 2013, Indonesia was second number from the bottom, meaning Indonesia is way down there in terms of literacy. Why is it matter? Because literacy is actually becomes the foundation of the nation, of students to survive and to prosper in 21st century, because this becomes a very significant factor to improve their skills and also to prosper in 21st century. If this literacy level is very low, meaning that any solutions regarding our education trend right now might not work. It is assumed like that. Now, let's take a look at the latest issue in our education trend. Meaning that they come to school, they learn English, for example, my major in English, or maybe they learn mathematics, they learn engineering. The question is that those subjects are not actually in line with what the expectation, or the majors are not in line with the expected market right now. We live in a very dynamic and economic-driven community, so it is assumed and it is expected that our education major and education trend should answer those needs, and also students can learn maximally and how to empower their potential maximally to our education later on in the future, so they can prosper in 21st century situation or the 21st century context. Now, I would like to start the idea for 21st century skills from the plan, from the study from World Economic Forum. Why World Economic Forum? Because the perspective right now in developed or developing countries are all in the economy. Factor is very important. Now, according to the study by World Economic Forum, in terms of literacy skills, or maybe skills that is needed in 21st century, there are three main components. First, foundational literacies. Second, it's all about competency and also character qualities. So what I mean as a foundational literacy here, there are some skills, if the students want to be successful and they want to survive in 21st century, it is expected that they should have these skills, so in order they can compete, in order they can empower themselves and also their community in 21st century, the absence of these skills might influence their problems or might influence their performance in the future. Now let's take a look. The first aspect of 21st century skills is on foundational literacies. It deals with how the students apply core skills in everyday life. For example, the skill of literacy, numeracy, and also scientific thinking. And ICT, of course, yes, but the subsidy is asked for from ICT to further still, because it's assumed that students with higher economy level might perform better than students with lower economy background. And also, cultural and speak literacy. The second idea of the skills in the 21st century is that competency, we need to help the students deal with the problems in daily life in the future. So there are some aspects that skills, for example, students can be survived if they have good critical thinking and also the ability in terms of problem solving. Second is that students can survive if they have good creativity. Students can survive if they have good communication skills and also they can collaborate with others. So these skills are very important, but sometimes we forget in our classroom. So the last aspect is character qualities. It's related to how the student approaches to the changing environment, especially in the 21st century. Environment is very dynamic. It's related to how students build curiosity and also initiative. It means that if students have good initiative, it means that in the future, so they have a good motivation, intrinsic motivation to expand.
Please let me say while I deliver this presentation, because I think it will re-energize myself after a long way from Yogyakarta. Before I present what I found during my research, I want to thank you to you all for the patience until this afternoon to listen to pay attention to our research finding. So, my research title is Higher Education for Sustainable Development is an Utopian Concept. So, Higher Education for Sustainable Development, or as a common we said, Education for Sustainable Development, is a kind of a new concept in education. So, I think this is still based on rising in the education, right? Just for information, I'm a master's student in the Jemaah University in management and public policy, so education is not really my field, but I'd like to talk about and find more about the education. Okay. So, let's start with the introduction, of course. So, as we know that higher education has a significant role in human resource development. So, the significant role is the significant ingredient to achieve the SDGs 4.7, which is producing quality education. What is producing education quality or quality education? The Nobel aim of this SDGs is global human prosperity in 2030. So, how could higher education have effort or have something to achieve global human prosperity in 2030? United Nations wish that higher education can produce human. Not only they are who can compete in labor market or who can get involved in increasing economic growth, but also who has an attention, who has a concern to the environment protection and also the social inclusion. So these four factors is very, very important to achieve global human prosperity in 2030 to higher education. So these four factors or these four aspects are represented in higher education for sustainable development. That's the big idea of this research background. So the introduction. So most of research is for sustainable development, are were concerned about the economic and the employment aspect only, but and also the environmental aspect. But the social aspect, the social inclusion aspect, is left behind so far until this stage. And I have four research contributions. First is describing an inequality between KK and I of Kakak Kualifikasi Nasional Indonesia, Best Curriculum and SDGs 4.7. I was, from this first point, I want to see whether our curriculum, our KK and I, can support the SDGs 4.7. And the second contribution from this research is presenting the role of community in achieving SDGs. And the third is describing the role of Antarctica community in facilitating informal education for society. And the fourth is problem identification of achieving Kalimantan community's goals. So as I said before, there are many researchers did some researches about education for sustainable development, were concerned in environment and economic aspect, or you can say employment aspect, but they just forgot about the social inclusion or the social, aspect. And the method, I just use some casual method, systematic literature review, stakeholders interview, and documentation retrieving. And yeah, these were employed together and analyzed the data. Okay, so let's start with the utopia. What is utopia? Some people have maybe different perception about utopia. Some people say that utopia is a myth. Utopia is something that we can achieve. Utopia is just a legend. And I try to come to all the utopian concept from literature. So here we go. I have like five keywords of utopia that I started with this research. First is social perfection. So as a human, we want to do a better and better and achieve a better life and live in a better world. So that's what utopian means. And the second one is ideal world. And the third one is hope. So when we talk about the utopian concept, we also talk about the hope. So the fourth is speculative myth, or the myth that actually can be achieved. And the last one is critic. So utopia is a concept that come or birth to critique the social condition now, which is not really ideal. So people want to change the social condition to the ideal condition.
Okay, today, this afternoon, I would like to talk about theoretical review on continuing professional development for EFL teachers, especially. But it can also be, can be also implemented for a broader disciplines, not only for English teaching. Okay, so first of all, what is professional here? Professional is a word to define a trained and qualified specialist who has a high competence in a particular field. So not only English teaching, but also in other fields, because our theme today is very broad, and I believe it can be beneficial for every one of you. Well, professionalism is a practitioner's skill, knowledge, and the conduct. First of all, we would like to make it clear about the professional development itself. There are two kinds of professional development. The first is for a pre-service teacher, and the second is for the in-service teacher. These two are very different. For pre-service teacher, the activities of professional development is a kind of training for preparing the teacher. And the teachers in this training are recipients in the process of knowledge transfer from the experts. And it excludes the classroom teaching context. And usually it has short-term and immediate goals, for example, for passing the course by PPL. Well, for instructors teacher, it is continuous and it has longer-term goals. It helps teachers to grow their profession as a constructivist perspective, and it focuses on how teachers grow by reflecting, review, or examining their own teaching beliefs, values, and practices. Okay, my job in the title is Continuing Professional Development. Why? Because it is in line with Jay, that he stated that professional development consists all of natural learning experiences and those conscious and planned activities which are intended to be direct or indirect benefit to the individual or even the school. And it can give contribution to the quality of education in the classroom. And this process can be done alone or with other people, and the teacher review, renew, and expand their commitment as a change agent to the moral purpose of teaching. And they will acquire and develop critically the knowledge and skills and even emotional intelligence essential to good professional thinking, planning, and practice with students, young people, and colleagues. Okay, so in short, we can describe the characteristic of continuing professional development. Of course, the first one, it is continuous. And it is the individual's responsibility to identify the what to be developed, and how to develop. And the activity is rather evaluative, okay? And it is an essential component, not just an extra activity. So it is suggested that professional development is planned and regularly conducted. Okay, just like Yoli presented in his book, that there are traditional practices of professional development, and also he proposed his view. Okay, so he proposed that professional development is a collaborative decision making. So here the administrators need to collaborate with the teachers in planning and arranging the program. So it is not a top-down decision making. So the teacher here need to be involved. And it is also a growth-driven approach. It means that we need to listen to the teachers, what they experience in the classroom, and what are they strengths and weaknesses. So it can be collaborated in the planning of the program. So that's why it is a collective construction of the programs. The next is the professional development should be inquiry-based ideas, which means that you need to find information on how the teachers think on transferring the teaching techniques given in the professional development activity to transfer it to the classroom. And next is the tailor-made techniques. So here, when we want to program a professional development activity, we need to consider the needs of the teachers. Is it really important or is it really needed by the teachers? And also, we need to regard the level of the teacher. Are they novice teacher or are they experienced teacher? Of course, the approach given in the program will be different. And the next, it is varied and timely delivery methods. It should be varied methods given to the teacher, and the time is wisely considered. And next, it gives adequate support system, so not only conducting workshop, for example, and just let it be without any support or result evaluation. And next, it should be context-specific programs and proactive assessment. And the last is adult-centered instruction. Don't forget that in-service teacher is different from preceptive teacher. So the approach or the activity in the program should be well managed, because adults usually like behavioristic, like direct learning, not only just the theory but also involved in the learning. objective of professional development. For better results, it is believed that we have to join the individual perspective with the institutional perspective so they can be in line and achieve the result, the goal. The areas of individual professional development includes the following. The first is the subject matter knowledge, like grammar, phonology, morphology, testing, methodology, and pedagogical expertise, like teaching specializations, different skills teaching abilities, speaking, listening, or reading, or writing, teaching ability based on age or background. Self-awareness, it relates to individual's knowledge as a teacher, knowledge of principle and values, knowledge of individual's strength and weaknesses. Understanding of learners, it deals with learners' learning style, learners' problems and difficulties, and figuring out effective ways of teaching. And the next area is understanding curriculum and materials. And the last is the career advancement.